Hello everyone. First of all, apologies. I did not do an interview for really, really long, but of course, the time has come. The results have started coming for the fall 2019, as they say, rujhan aane chalu ho gaye hain. So I'm glad to begin this year's Star Admit video interview series, as I want to call it, through one of our students, Shivani.
Thank you so much.
And Shivani has, accomplished a feat, which is accomplished, probably I think she's the only one from Indore or Central India to do that. Shivani is this year's ISB Admit, Indian School of Business, India's number one business school. So Shivani, first of all, congratulations.
Thank you so much.
And in many ways, I feel that your journey and your accomplishment is absolutely special. As I've seen your journey and the way you have grown right from your engineering days to this very point. So tell us, how does it feel to really, now you'll be a part of ISB class 2019-20. How it feels?
So absolutely, the feeling is amazing. It's I do realize the magnitude of this achievement, and it wasn't an easy journey. So I feel like one of those special ones, selected ones, because ISB gets thousands of applications from across the world every year, and I always had this feeling that I won't be able to get an MBA so soon, because generally MBA programs place a lot of importance on work experience.
I agree. Yeah.
And so the average work experience is between 4 to 5 years, and I thought that maybe my 2.5 years work experience might prove to be a hurdle in my journey towards ISB, but now that I've lived that journey and I've managed to get here, I think the feeling is really special to be a part of such a diverse cohort at ISB.
Well, I think all of you would be interested to know what is her background now, since how she made it to ISB. So of course we want to get into that discussion only. So you graduated as an engineer, Shivani.
Yes.
Now, I think it'll be very surprising for all of, for our entire audience to know what exactly you did and why did you choose a different path after engineering. So tell us what you exactly did after computer science bachelor's.
So it has been a very crazy journey, and I've done a lot of diverse things. So I started with engineering. I did my engineering from Indore itself, from Acropolis, mm-hmm. and I majored in computer science. But in my very first year, I realized that my heart doesn't belong in engineering. My idea, aim to do engineering, was to build a technically and analytically strong backbone, mm-hmm. and also develop that sort of objective thinking that comes with the idea of being an engineer once you're trained, that when you study those courses. Mm-hmm. But I was very invested into extracurriculars, be it running my college quarterly chronicle, or probably working as an editor for some of the online digital magazines in Indore, or probably running a lot of these non-profit chapters like National Entrepreneurship Network or Young India for my college. So there was a lot of exposure, mm-hmm. and there was a lot of learning. And through that journey, I kind of realized what my strengths are, what my weaknesses are. And I found myself being drawn to a lot of creative organizational pursuits. And it all came back to communication. My love for communication dates back till high school. So I've always been enamored by words and writing. So I think I started learning about public relations. I used to research a lot, and somewhere that seed was sowed to pursue public relations. In my third year in college, I also did an international entrepreneurial course. So it also opened my thinking per se when I got the opportunity to open Indore's first campus company run by students with my teammates. So I think all of these experiences actually gave me those skills to survive and maybe find my way to public relations. Mm-hmm. But having said that, it wasn't an easy journey, because I knew nobody in Mumbai. I knew nothing about the industry. It's a very alien industry, especially when you come from an engineering background. So my love for communication drew me to PR. Mm-hmm. And finally, I started finding my niche in Bombay. I started with handling certain lifestyle and fashion clients.
Uh-huh.
But then I soon found my feet in travel and lifestyle. So I got the opportunity to work for a host of travel clients, international travel clients like Los Angeles Tourism, South African Tourism. And then there were certain lifestyle tech clients like Jet Privilege and even Tinder for that matter.
Okay.
So I think in that 2 years, I was probably able to pack in a lot more diverse experience than I think some people get to do in more traditional careers. And I also learned a lot about strategy, planning. When you're handling a communication mandate for a client, you have to know about everything related to that industry. So I think that also helped me really open my mind and see world through a new lens. And I was sure by the end of 2 years that MBA is what's next. I thought I was ready. I thought I had the skills. And because I had held a lot of leadership positions, I thought that my chances to get into a world-renowned B school stand a little higher, even though what I lack in quantity of experience, I make up in quality of experience as well.
So in a sense, you know, you did your bachelor's in engineering.
Yeah.
I'm very curious to know when you started hating engineering or computer science or programming.
So I never really hated engineering. I used to look at coding and I thought this is what I can do, but my heart doesn't belong here. It's just something that I could see that people around me, my classmates, were so passionate about something like coding. And I used to think to myself, why is it not resonating to me the way it is resonating to them? And I was always determined to make sure that I don't limit myself to traditional classroom learning. So that was my bait to actually kind of get into extracurriculars.
Great.
I thought if I have to perform well, now that I've taken engineering, I need something to like keep my mind ignited and keep myself on the edge. So that's how I ventured out into extracurriculars. But then I found my heart there. So it was a journey. It was a journey of self-discovery. I didn't have a plan. It's a lot of learning and unlearning about yourself that happened over the years.
So I'm trying to understand here, since you are putting a lot of emphasis on what kind of extracurricular activities you know, you did during undergrad. So I think probably students should be looking at, you know, while they're selecting their undergrad campuses, they should be looking what level of undergrad, you know, exposure, and at the same time, how much emphasis that college is imparting on extracurricular activities and how many clubs that they have. Isn't it right?
I couldn't agree more, because, you know, when you look for a... I mean, when you go for a college like ISB, they do not rely solely on academic qualification at all. It's about the person you are. They're really interested to know you. They're really interested to understand what you bring to the table. And I think these extracurriculars will not only help you stand apart from the crowd, but also will give you these skills that are transferable skills. So you can apply them. I mean, through extracurriculars, you learn about teamwork, which is helpful whether you go into a traditional industry or an untraditional one. So I think it's a win-win. It's a 360 degree development. So I think it's very important.
So I think Shivani is that engineer who did not pursue a conventional computer science career like Infosys, TCS, what everybody does. But she understood that through those participations in extracurricular activities, she evolved as a communicator. She evolved as a team player and a leader. And then probably, you know, broadened her horizon accordingly. So I think...
I would like to make a special mention here that engineering... So I am a strong believer that nothing you do ever goes to waste.
Absolutely.
So
yes.
I think engineering really gave me that edge in PR where all my supervisors unanimously agreed that I have a knack for data crunching and analytics. So that's something...
The technical bend, the analytical bend that you develop.
Correct. And you will not come across a lot of communication professionals who are equally intrigued by numbers or data. So I think in the industry that I was operating in and the kind of stories that we had to work on, that really came handy. And that's another skill that I could add to my profile and possibly connect the dots to show my journey to ISB.
Wow, lovely. So I think undergrad and then, you know, getting into the media and public relation industry. And then possibly she thought that... because she want to be a leader and a managerial profession, right? I think you would all be excited to know that her Gmat was mind-boggling 740. So congratulations on that too.
Thank you so much.
And this is valid for 5 years. I'm sure you want to use it again somewhere.
Yes, totally.
How 740 Gmat? So a lot of Gmat aspirants are watching.
Yeah.
Tell them. How did you achieve that 740? What was your strategy of getting a 740 GMAT? And that was your first attempt, right?
Yes, that was
brilliant.
Attempt.
So go ahead.
So I think I never even dreamt about 740. When I came to you for the first time, I said I just want to cross 700. Because what I lacked probably in quantity of experience, I would want to make up and showing excellence in other parts of my profile. And there was a lot of chaos outside regarding how to prepare for an exam. If you research online, there are so many resources, so many people selling, you know, all these courses online, quick courses, e-videos. So I was very confused, very confused. I didn't even know how to start. But I think the most important part is to know how to start, to chart out a plan. I as a person tend to work in a very organized way. So for me to start anything, I need to have that layout on the paper, how the roadmap is looking. And I think we sat and brainstormed about it.
Yeah.
Another key thing is that, you know, people think that you have to spend a lot of money to get a really good score or to really perform. Our discussion also centered around that I want to do it with minimum investment.
Absolutely.
I don't want to put my money in online resources, buying
yeah,
a lot
so
of...
So many of them.
Yeah, there's like endless number of books and resources.
Yeah.
So I think it was very basics. You told me to start with Manhattan,
yeah.
get done with the basics, then maybe move to OG, which is the official resource.
Official guide.
And all of these are easily available. These are the basic investments you will have to do.
And these official test preps are now, what is there, 8 tests around.
Yes.
That's fantastic.
Yes,
yeah.
It is absolutely amazing. But I think 740 was a lot of consistency. I mean, I studied day in and day out for 3 months. That's the timeline I had set for myself.
3 months you took
3 months.
To prepare.
Yeah.
And 3 months I probably have seen it preparing. And I think planned and consistent. That was what, you know, completely planned studies. And her whole schedule was pretty much fixed.
Yes.
For the
but then
day.
I came to you that I want to give Gmat now that I've studied everything possibly under the sun. And but then you said, no, you know what, you've just studied, now start giving the tests. I think that's what made the difference. So in the last 1 month, all I gave was tests. We gave around 25 mock tests like you suggested.
Mm-hmm.
I think that really gave me the bandwidth to survive a four and a half hour exam.
Excellent.
That drains you mentally and exhausts you. So you really need to get into that zone and keep giving tests, because the more you practice, the better you get.
And I think when you just have completed 2 years of experience, you don't have 3, 4, 5 years of experience, in that context, I think 740 gives you that confidence that
certainly.
I can at least apply. I know I have least possible work experience,
that's
but
true.
I can at least try for a good B score.
That's true. I mean, I was very nervous. I would have been happy just to cost 700. But while attempting the exam, I could see how those tests and that 3 months of dedicated practice work. And I literally spend my money nowhere else except at just 3 types of basic books, Manhattan, Veritas and OG. I did not go beyond it. But I realized that GMAT is a little different than other exams because
uh-huh.
it's a lot of strategy.
Correct.
It's not, you don't have to be a grammar Nazi to ace the verbal section of GMAT.
Uh-huh.
But you need to understand the strategy and the construction that goes behind the verbal questions that you're getting. So I think that was my big learning from GMAT probably.
I think while you prepare for GMAT and probably any other entrance, analyzing why those options which are not the right one, why they are wrong.
Correct.
And that probably, you
Correct.
Know, you have to make notes for them. And then
Certainly.
You start identifying with the options after
yeah.
a certain period of time.
Yeah, I mean, every mistake that you do now is one less mistake you'll do in the exam.
Absolutely.
So that's kind of how it worked out. And I think that's how, I think it was also... also, selecting the right center is extremely important.
Center?
Yes,
okay.
It is a very important decision.
Mm-hmm.
And I think it's also important to a kind of recce. So I always recommend people to go visit the center one day before they have their exam.
Absolutely.
So they can
spot.
Familiarize with themselves, with the surroundings, know if the center is okay, if the machines are working fine, if they are, the appointment is still live.
Right.
So I think that really helped me calm my nerves. But except that, a good night's sleep and staying hydrated for the duration of the exam makes a lot of difference. More difference than people can imagine.
Okay. And while you were giving the test,
yeah.
You know, how endurance came into picture?
It did, because by the end of 3 hours after I was done with my verbal and quant, I had a terrible headache. It was so difficult for me to keep going and all because it was a hot summery day.
Uh-huh.
And I realized that in the breaks, I made sure I have some power snacks. I'm having some protein bars with me. I'm having enough water. So that's what my breaks were all about. Not about revising or anything. And I could do my verbal section like 5 minutes before the timer ran out. So I did not submit my verbal section. I used those 5 minutes to kind of calm my mind
yeah,
down.
Breathe
and,
out.
Yeah.
Yes.
So that gave me some additional time.
Well, I think that's a common mistake that students, you know, do these days. If they have a, you know, test time
yeah.
at a certain date around 3 o'clock, they would reach the same morning in Delhi
Correct.
And Bombay or Ahmedabad,
Correct.
Which is completely wrong.
Which is completely
They
wrong.
Should be arriving there at least a day before.
Yeah, at least see what's the rasta to your center and kind of get familiarized with it.
So, now, of course, you got the GMAT, you thought that, you know, I have decent work experience, right? And of course, you always had the confidence with you.
Yeah.
How did you really strategize the ISB, you know, application? Of course, I remember all our sessions, but I want to know that, you know, what was the entire process till the point you submitted the application?
So I was very clear about one thing, that if I want to do MBA from India, I'm only going to do it from ISB.
Fantastic.
I had no backups, no other options from India's standpoint. And it was a very long but a very well thought out process for ISB. The first step was obviously submitting your score. And then essays play the most important role in your MBA application. So I think essays just want to know everything about you in possibly like 300, 350 words. Which was my biggest challenge. I struggled to tell my entire story in 300, 350 words. And I think that's why we worked around some 12 drafts of the same essay before submitting
that.
It. So it was a big process. I mean, you have to think about your entire life, what you did, when, why you did, how did it contribute to make you the person you are, and just put it down into words. So I think the thing that really helped me was brainstorming. When you share, so what I did was I shared my entire story with you. And if I'm running out of instances to state as examples, you were always there to remind me that, you know, oh, you did this, so possibly this is an example that meets the requirements there. So I think being precise, being concise, and not beating too much around the bush. So
correct.
Essays have to be on
and
point.
And being authentic.
Being authentic. You have to be yourself. They are very smart people. They can read through lies. They can read between the lies. So be yourself. I mean, I knew that I had taken a break from my work to pursue Gmat. I knew that that space, that gap will always be there, but I wanted to be true to my story. I understood why I had done what I had done, and there was no qualms about admitting it. So being authentic is, I think, extremely important. And then it's a regular registration process with your 12 standard marks. But I think ISB plays a lot of importance on extracurriculars. So ISB is looking for excellence, is what I've learned. In whatever you do, you don't have to be excellent in 100 or 2000 things, but in whatever you've done, if you've proved excellence, ISB will be intrigued by your profile.
Right.
So I had to amplify my profile with a lot of extracurriculars, which thankfully I had invested time in. And so it all came around, and they're very quick with their reviewing processes and everything. And we got an interview invite in January with a 5-day heads up for the interview.
Yeah. So at the time you got you submitted the essays and application, and then what was that ISB interview like? What was the nature of it? Was it intimidating? What did they ask? Right. So I think sharing that those interview tips would be very crucial for our, you know, audience.
I think I was floored by ISB's interview process. I mean, that's what makes ISB stand out in all other B schools in India. That it's so practical, and it just lays so much of importance in overall personality. They are not looking to grill you. They are not looking to pressurize you. It's never a pressure interview. That's the first thing we were told in the morning, that, you know, it's a conversation. Treat it like a conversation. ISB also has really high standards when it comes to transparency and making sure that the decisions are unbiased. So they don't reveal your GMAT score or your school scores, etc., high school marks,
mm-hmm.
to the interviewers. So it's just your profile and your essays.
Mm-hmm.
And you're just judged on that. So I think that's the highest level of implementation of ensuring that the decisions are unbiased.
Absolutely.
And they match you with the interviewers according to your profile.
Okay.
So there were around 10 to 12 panels, and everybody was matched according to their profile.
Mm-hmm.
So I got interviewers who probably understood what background I came from and who could engage with me.
Mm-hmm.
So the whole idea was that the vibe was really comfortable. They make you comfortable, and they tell you that we already know ISB likes you. Now
Fantastic.
Tell us why you belong here.
Right.
So it was very encouraging, and I think that really helps you, calms your nerve down, and you just have to be honest. Just tell why you want to be at ISB. What have you done so far? What makes you think that you are MBA ready?
Mm-hmm.
And what are your future goals?
Supposedly, I mean, just imagining a situation that, you know, if there was a situation that if I, you know, ISB did not accept you, what would have been your plan B at this point of time?
I think I would have gone back to the drawing board, because ISB was the only place I wanted to do an MBA from, especially in India, like I said. Because most of the international universities, they stress upon 4 to 5 years of work experience.
Yeah, yeah.
And that's why there's a high chance that I'm going to get a lot of deferred admits. But I knew I wanted to do it this year. But had it not converted, I wouldn't have settled with anything else. I mean, anything less than the best.
Really wonderful to know your inputs, you know, on your entire journey. So, of course, I've seen you, you know, when from your GRE days, you know,
yeah.
when you were pursuing your engineering.
Yeah.
And then you took up a very conscious call of, you know, getting some work experience and eventually going for an MBA.
Yeah.
So, overall, as you've evolved through your career, it has been a fantastic journey, Shivani. I must congratulate you on your the way you've approached things, the certainty that you have shown, the confidence that you've shown in yourself. I think it would be wonderful that we end the interview with your words of wisdom through your experience for everybody out there who want to make a career in the management, right? And in general also.
I think I would just want to say, be clear, be authentic, know what you want and get the right guidance, because you can't do it all on your own. I mean, there's a reason there are specialists in each domain.
Agreed.
So I think that really helped me. Had I just went out to just chart my own journey and try to convert everything on my own, there's
keep
so,
discussing with experts
yeah,
and people
yeah.
around them, right?
And do your research well. I think it's very clear. It's very important that you do your research well. And I can't end this without giving a shout out to Globalizers, because that's
Thank
where
you.
The difference came. I mean, I've been connected with you and the organization for the last 4 or 5 years. And I've seen the kind of impact it's happening, especially in a city like Indore, which was like hitherto considered still a little behind the metros, but
yes.
now we're really raising that bar, and the kind of admissions and the recruits that we are getting, it's quite wonderful. So reach out. Don't be afraid to ask for help.
Thank you. So ladies and gentlemen, this was Shivani for you, ISB admit for this year, and she has made the Indore Central India and all of us proud. And we really deserve to be inspired by her journey. So all of you, keep working hard, be ambitious, and see you in the next video very soon. Thank you so much for watching. All the best.